What's very important about generative AI is that now anyone, even people who do not want to put themselves through the masochism of learning a programming language, anyone can try to get something automated. Anyone can now make the attempt to ask for a computer to do the hard work of combing through this awful hoarder's storage locker. Now we can say, this is what I want, this is what I'm looking for, and potentially we would be able to have the computer do that for us. But the most important thing that you would have to do is to know what you want in the first place and be able to articulate it. And that is the biggest skill of tomorrow and the biggest skill in the generative AI world. It may be easy to get a machine without learning anything. You don't have to learn anything first. You can just ask for what you want. It may be easy for it to get a machine to do it. The things may be available because we have such abundant information. But do you know how to express what you want? That's the key.
So it's less about the data that it's being trained on and more about the way we interface with that data?
That's what the generative AI revolution is really about. The kind of AI firstness I don't want to see at the organizational level is where we're asking, how do I put AI in my business? Instead, what I want to see is I want to see leaders asking a very different question. I want to see them saying, what's important? And then, given that I've understood what's important, what used to be impossible, which, if it were possible today, would be useful? AI firstness for an organization is to kick down the door and have a look at all those things again, because yesterday's impossible might be possible today.
If we're thinking about big organizations that have their own, you know, they're training their own models, how do they discern good data from bad and not just like go and hoard all the data?
I think we have to turn things around and take responsibility for how we're going to see the world and ask ourselves, well, what would it take to change our minds? What do we understand by the concept of truth? But perhaps more importantly, coming back to your very first question about data, which you may think is related to truth, evidence, facts, and so on, how does what you think you know relate to how you're going to act and be and behave and influence other people and change the world by being in it? And then you go and collect all the evidence. Then you go and find the good data. I told you I would land this plane eventually, half an hour later. You find the good data that you have said is appropriate. Now, when you start to see this type of framing, it becomes a matter of responsibility and trust as well. Do you trust yourself with your own decision-making? Would you like to delegate the decision to somebody else?
Can you give me an example, no specifics, of employing it in a practical scenario?
You start with the notion of what I'd call a default action. This is what I'm going to do if nobody tells me anything additional. In my starting point right now, I may choose to, let's say, not launch a big machine learning system, which is the type of decision that I would be involved in. I could instead say, with no further information, let's launch it. Which default you pick is a matter, again, of decision responsibility. Is it better with no information to release a thing, or is it better with no information to not release a thing? So then you, as the decision maker in this big position of responsibility, have to say, okay, let's say my default action is let's use the previous version of technology unless we have evidence that this new one is better. Then we say, well, what is the evidence that it would take to convince me? How good does it need to be, the system I'm going to release? What would it take to change our minds? There's not one right answer to a question like that. It is a decision-making question. And that is why the discipline of decision intelligence focuses on the leader and the decision maker and the actions under consideration as the starting point. What is your mindset to? What would it take to change it? What are all the factors going on? What does it mean to automate with data and to do that responsibly and be convinced that you have made not the right call? I worry about words like right. I'm a little too much of a grumpy statistician for that, but a thoughtful judgment call.
In your day-to-day, do you ever intuit decisions and like just be
all
like—
All the time.
You do.
All the time. So one of the big principles in decision intelligence and sensible living is that you should first think about your priorities and you should try to spend effort on decisions of an appropriate scale with what's at stake. The first thing you have to realize is that, what's that thing they say? Man is mortal. You don't have all the time in the world. You don't have all the resources in the world. And so you must choose and you must prioritize. And if you never get into touch with your priorities, you will float randomly through life. It will be like having no steering wheel. In many ways, decision intelligence is the steering wheel for your life in a technological world where you might be able to scale yourself a whole lot. If you're never in touch with your priorities, you just will achieve what life throws at you. You will be a passenger rather than a driver without any kind of steering wheel. Of course, because there is uncertainty, there are things that you will never see coming, there are things outside your control, your steering wheel, any steering wheel you have, doesn't guarantee you a good outcome. Of course, there are things that I will intuit through all the time. I don't have time to be technical about them. And nor do I want to, because they're not important to me. And they could be so deeply important to somebody else. Which is why we don't want to use words like right and the only way to do things. But when you use intuition, sometimes you're actually doing a really great integration of data, because we have evolved the ability to be pretty good in certain settings and at certain types of decisions. And when we slow down and we try to use a pros and cons list or spreadsheet or machine learning model, whatever it is, we may actually find ourselves worse at doing whatever thing it is, than just going with our gut. Also, going with your gut is pretty good when you have a lot of experience in a domain. What you've seen is relevant to what you're going to make a judgment call about. You should be very careful about going with your gut when you're dealing with very important decisions in situations where you have never seen anything that could be relevant, that could have informed your gut.